In the spring of 1940, as Britain reeled from defeats in all fronts and America seemed frozen in isolation, one fear united the British and American leaders like no other: that Hitler's Germany might win the race to build the world's first atom bomb. That Adolf Hitler's Germany might win the race to build the world's first atom bomb was arguably one of Winston Churchill's greatest wartime concerns, and one that was shared with his good friend, US President Franklin D. Roosevelt. When Churchill flew across the Atlantic to meet Roosevelt to discuss this issue, they agreed no effort could be spared to stop Hitler from getting the bomb, for with it, he would win control over the world. So great were the wartime leaders' fears that Roosevelt demanded immediate action to sabotage Hitler's nuclear efforts. Only Britain had the capacity to respond. Churchill ordered a series of dramatic raids by his volunteers for special duties, his commandos, special operations executive agents and special forces, unique fighting men and women ideally suited to such near-suicide missions. Those daring raids targeted the giant heavy water plant at Vemork in German-occupied Norway, among other facilities which formed a key element of the Germans' nuclear program, and was the only element deemed vulnerable to Allied sabotage. Churchill's launched a top-secret mission, codenamed Operation Peppermint, a covert program to prepare Britain for a Nazi dirty bomb being exploded over London. Operation Peppermint, arguably the most secret project of the entire war, aimed to provide early warning and whatever protection might be possible in the event of a nuclear strike by Nazi Germany on Britain. Secrecy was paramount, for Churchill feared mass panic and a collapse of wartime morale. Such fears were real. Following German physicist Otto Hahn splitting the atom in December 1938, the Allies believed the Germans to be 2 years ahead in the race to build the atom bomb. Those fears were massively exacerbated when Germany seized Czechoslovakia prior to war's outbreak, for in the mountains north of the country was Europe's only uranium mine. Joachimsthal is an ancient spa town in what was then northern Czechoslovakia, situated in the Ore Mountains. Following the seizure of the Joachimsthal mines in 1938, the German metallurgy company Auer Gesellschaft began shipping uranium ore to Oranienburg in northeast Germany, where it began industrial-scale production of high-purity uranium, the raw material required to build the atom bomb. With Nazi Germany's seizure of Norway in 1940, Hitler's Reich took control of Norsk Hydro Vemork plant, the only facility in Europe making heavy water, the other key component for a nuclear reactor and for breeding atom bombs. Just 24 hours prior to marching into Norway, Nazi General Nicolas von Falkenhorst had led his troops into Denmark, occupying the nation in a matter of hours. In doing so, Nazi forces had seized Copenhagen along with its Institute of Theoretical Physics, whose founder and key luminary was Niels Bohr, a man many considered to be the grandfather of atomic research. Among the top scientists that Bohr had mentored during the pre-war years was Werner Heisenberg, a German physicist who was then the chief mover and shaker at the Uranverein, Nazi Germany's uranium club, set up at war's outbreak to perfect the Third Reich's nuclear weapons program. In May 1940, German forces struck a further series of seminal blows in the race for nuclear supremacy. On May 10th, their forces overran Belgium, seizing at Olen the largest remaining stocks of uranium in all of Europe and possibly the world. Allied research suggested it would require 20,000 workers, 500,000 watts of electricity, and $150 million in expenditure to build the world's first atom bomb, a totalitarian state run by a dictator who now controlled most of Western Europe could demand such resources, and in the concentration camps, Hitler had access to millions of slaves. In short, the Führer could harness Germany's foremost engineering capabilities to its scientific expertise and Western Europe's almost unlimited resources, all of which made an atom bomb a real possibility. By the autumn of 1943, Churchill's Operation Peppermint was in full swing, and specialist teams equipped with Geiger counters or radiation detectors were dispatched to Britain's key cities. Expert reports outlined the dangers of the military use of fission products by the enemy. In other words, highly radioactive products from nuclear reactors being spread over Britain's streets. Such fears reached their zenith when Nazi Germany's V-weapon program geared up for the so-called Robo-Blitz in the autumn of 1943, wherein more than 3,000 V-2 rockets would pummel London, Antwerp, and other key Allied targets. Over the autumn of 1943, intelligence on V-1 and V-2 weapons seeped into Britain. Top-secret Allied reports spoke of liquid air bombs being developed in Germany of terrific destructive power. Stevenson, the quiet Canadian and Churchill's intelligence supremo, noted that these were very possibly Virgil Tang Waffa rockets carrying nuclear warheads. The V-1 flying bomb campaign was followed by the giant V-2 rockets, the first man-made objects to ever enter space. The V-2 plummeted to Earth at speeds in excess of 5,000 kilometers per hour. No anti-aircraft guns or warplanes could ever hope to intercept the V-2s or to shoot them down. The greatest fear was that the Nazis had mastered the technology to fit a nuclear or radiological charge to the V-2s, in which case there would be no defense possible. Churchill ordered aerial surveys to forewarn of such attacks, dry run rehearsals to prepare for such an ordeal, and for frontline doctors to be briefed on the symptoms of radiation poisoning. Secrecy was of paramount concern. That sabotage was ultimately successful, though at considerable cost. In the autumn of 1942, some 34 commandos flew into occupied Norway on two Horsa gliders, which were towed by Halifax bombers. Their target was a vast hydroelectric plant producing deuterium oxide or heavy water, a key component of the Nazis' nuclear war program, along with uranium. Sadly, those hemp tow ropes attaching the gliders to the tow aircraft froze solid in the icy conditions over Norway and they snapped. Those commandos not killed in the subsequent crash landings were captured, tortured by the SS and Gestapo, and executed horribly. The failure of that mission, codenamed Freshman, led to a very different approach being adopted by the Special Operations Executive. The commander of the SOE's Scandinavian section, former scoutsman and clandestine operations supremo, Major John Skinner Wilson, set in two further assault teams, codenamed Grouse and Gunnerside. Each consisted of a small contingent of Norwegian commandos, who had been trained and equipped in Britain, carrying explosives, skis, and survival gear. In an assault of unrivaled daring and bravery, those 12 SOE raiders led by Joachim Runnerberg, who, like most of his men, was still in his early 20s, managed to penetrate the plant's supposedly impregnable defense and to blow the deuterium oxide apparatus to smithereens. William Stevenson, Churchill's spymaster, would later say of those raiders, "If it had not been for the saboteurs' resolve, the Germans would have had the opportunity to devastate the civilized world. We would be either dead or living under Hitler's zealots." In the next episode of our World War II series, we'll talk about heroes of Telemark and how they sabotaged Hitler's atomic bomb program. So consider subscribing so you won't lose our future videos.